40 days of Lent, we have had, during that time, we've had people share about what the cross means for them. And then during this week, on Thursday, we had people share what communion or foot washing means to them. And then on Good Friday, if you're with us at that service, we had people share about what the death of Jesus means to them. And those are important things. And for me personally, I appreciated them because I've gotten to know people a little bit better, got to know people a little bit deeper. Today, we've had Cheryl Spencer from Nobin Way. If you maybe you recognize her, she works at the D&D Mobile Mart in Ingadine. And she's a great lady. And she shared what the death of Jesus, or what the resurrection means to her. And a little bit later, we're going to have, Zeke's going to share here in a little bit. And I'm going to give some time, if you were here during the weekend, or during the week services, I said I'd give time for any of you that might want to share about what does the resurrection of Jesus Christ mean to you. And so be ready for that. You'll have some time for that. And so the question is, what does it all mean? I mean, we do all this work. We get all this stuff done as a faith during this season. We hype up our services. We amp everything up, and we gear for this. And pastors get all worked up. I talk to pastors, and they're all worked up during this time of year, more so this time of year at Christmas. Christmas is busy, but the Holy Week, you know, we have every now and then. I remember having service on Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday night. Then Saturday, I got to get ready for Sunday, Easter Resurrection Sunday, and, you know, just bam, 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 bam. And so we amp up, and it becomes a stressful time of year for a lot of people, not just pastors, but other people, especially if you're cooking a big meal. Who's got a big meal planned? Anybody planning a big meal? A few people planning a big meal. The rest of us are coming over. What time are we? Just checking. Anyway, so you know, so what's it all mean? What is this all about? What's it have to do with anything, really? So I want to invite Zeke to come up. I want him to share his story about what the resurrection of Jesus means to Zeke. So Zeke, come on up.
You know, so I did this in Nobin Way, and Pastor Tim hasn't said anything to me yet, so you're going to get it the same way. And I guess, you know, I've been asked to talk a couple times up here, or sometimes I just talk. Amen. But I just have this overwhelming need all the time to tell everybody here that, you know, just because I'm up here on this stage and I'm standing here talking, doesn't mean that I'm not a sinner. It doesn't mean that I don't have shortcomings on a daily basis. And I'm working on those all the time. Easy. You just know more of them than anybody else. So I don't want to come across as, I don't want to come across as fake. So I'm just as real as you are. I have the same problems you have. So the simple answer about what the resurrection means to me, when I really broke all that down, it's everything to me. It's everything to my faith. And why I say that is I believe, to simplify it, without the resurrection of Christ, there isn't anything that's any different today than it was 2,000 years ago. And so to kind of show what I mean by that, and this might be boring to some of you guys, but this is just how my mind thinks. I always, when I'm studying the Bible, I'm trying to understand why did they talk like that. And the more I do, the more I understand, you know, Jesus taught at their level and at where he was at and what needed to be taught. And then there's always the social, what it's like around, what was the atmosphere like, you know, no different than here. Our atmosphere here in Rexton Christian Fellowship is different than it is down in Pensacola, Florida, right? It's just different. So what I say, it's nothing be any different than it was 2,000 years ago. Our society has kind of different tiers, and it's based on what we do. That's just how our society works. So I look at the Romans then, and I look at our government now. You know, they were kind of the dominant. They were the, you know, they were in control. People didn't even agree with a lot of it, but they were still in control. The Pharisees were more like the white collar or the management part of our communities now, the leadership of the churches. And I'm not trying to offend anybody when I say management, because I know people work in management, and I'm not calling you a Pharisee. I'm just trying to establish the tiers of the society then and now. And like the Jews and the Gentiles, you know, I took them, when I read the Bible, I take them as the blue collar, the semi-professional people, okay? Or maybe the middle-aged America now. And then the Samaritans, at least how I perceive it in the Bible, they were the level, entry-level people. You know, they were looked down upon maybe, or weren't given a lot of clout because they were Samaritans, or entry-level people in our society today. So, you know, we got different clothes, we've got different ways of transportation, communication, but society still has these steps and tiers and cliques and emotions and all that stuff. So again, without the resurrection, nothing changes. So in Jesus' time, you know, everybody thought they were following God's word because they had what we call now the Old Testament, which to them was just probably a testament. I don't know. I don't know what they called it. But to us now, it's the Old Testament, and that's how they lived. That was their law. And it was enforced by, you know, the basically the church leaders. And that gave them a semblance. You know, there was some structure there. But nobody showed, to me, nobody showed a relationship with God. Nobody showed love in relationship. Nobody accepted. It was absolute. If you didn't do this, you got stoned. If you didn't do this, you, whatever it was in their society. But that was the way it was. So along comes Jesus. And he changed all that in his teaching. And I think that through Jesus, exposure to Jesus, that was the start of people understanding their purpose. And as I get a little bit older, I start to understand that if we don't know what our purpose is yet, and sometimes we don't know and sometimes it changes, we really can't have that peace, that inner peace. And through Jesus coming, that started that process for us human beings, you know. It started us able to learn what he wanted us to do by through a relationship. And you learn and you grow, and that carries on today. So in this time of Jesus, so his followers, right, which would be us today, they bought in. They bought into the extent of their ability based on what their societal perception was of Jesus, based on what they knew about their testament, and the way that Jesus taught them. It all clicked together, so they were sold. They were bought in. You know, they joined the club, right? They were in. And they were really in. They were following him around. You know, they were going against the grain. They were going against the normal. And they got to see him perform these miracles, and that really kind of cinched the deal for them. And again, are we any different from that today? I don't think so. If we could see, if we could, you know, if this started happening in Rexton, we're in, right? Well, holy cow. You know, John had his cancer, and Jesus walked up and touched him, and he was healed. We could see that. We're in. We'll take it. He walked up and touched Daryl and made him pretty. We're in. Again, I'm trying to say that it's no different. Our society isn't any different than it was then. It looks different, but it's the same. So these guys bought in. These women bought in. They brought their children in. And again, a lot of people today say they believe in Christ. They believe in God, they say. Maybe not Christ, but they believe in God. But these people bought in. They said, hey, this guy's from God. Now, they didn't know if he was Elijah, prophet, savior, son of God, the Christ, God himself. I mean, he said those things. They were trying to understand. They were, you know, and he was right there, so they could go with this. It was happening. And because of this, it blew the world up. It blew that community up. It blew the leadership up. It blew the Pharisees up. And I said in Namway, it'd be no different than we're sitting here, and somebody comes in the back door and says, so stop this Easter service. This is nuts. You guys are crazy. This isn't true. That's what they were doing. They, they were being that person. They were being that group that was changing everything the way they thought. Now, so basically they're going against the grain. And I don't know, I assume people in here have done that in society or at a team level, at a marriage level, at a family level, at a business level. And I've done that in my life several times now. And that's a tough spot to be. But when you feel it in here and you've got the nerve to do it, it's a blessing of strength in the big picture, right? When it's all done, you go, hey, yep, thank God I had the ability to do that. But when it's happening, when that person walks through the church and said, hey, you guys are nuts, or they were following Jesus and the Pharisees were, well, in that time, in the reality of it all happening, it's lonely. You know, you question yourself. You doubt your thoughts. You question the confidence that you had when you started. But they kept going. They knew enough. They felt enough. They had enough that they could see that they kept on going, the followers of Christ. And so to me, when they kept doing that, sometimes when we get saved, we can relate. Everybody gets saved. I didn't have a big experience. But a lot of times when people get saved, they feel that they're in, right? They're going. And it feels right. It feels free. You know, it feels strong, you know, passionate. You feel love. And ultimately, I think you start to find your purpose. And that's why it feels so good. And I think that's how they felt. So again, no different how we feel things than how they felt things. And then ultimately, they're getting to that purpose. And I think that purpose is key. So they buy in just like a new believer buys in, just like we buy in. And then here comes the world, the real world that we live in. And it's sinful, and things of this world die, right? We physically die. Our trees die. Our dogs die. Our animals die. Our vehicles die. It all dies. So again, without the resurrection, what value is it? You know, in Jesus' time, the world came in and we saw anger, we saw pain, we saw selfish deceit. And then the followers of Jesus saw that in, you know, they thought the Pharisees, and we have a tendency to look at the Pharisees and get mad. I get mad when I see what the Roman soldiers did to Jesus. I get frustrated, I get angry, I get sick to my stomach. And Jesus' followers had it. So here they buy in, they're against the grain, they're doing everything. Everybody thinks they're crazy. The numbers start to grow, and then everybody was more powerful. So you can kind of see this happening. And then they take Jesus, they beat the snot out of him. They humiliate him, they falsely accuse him, right? And they're all sitting there watching this. And they can see it. They don't dare go up and do anything about it because then they'll get beat up or they'll get, you know, they don't have any strength in society. They're following Jesus. They don't have anything in society. So then they drag Jesus to the cross. Actually, they make himself drag himself to the cross. And they crucify him. You know, the people, the leadership, the community that was losing control crucified him. And that's what the people see. That's what his followers saw. So what were they feeling? They were a mess, I'm sure. They're scared. And this crucifixion thing, picture that. You know? Pick on somebody that's got a son. Charlie. Give me Charlie. Give me your son, Charlie, and let me do that to him. And you sit there and watch, Sheila. You sit there and watch your son hang there and die. The crucifixion is the cruelest form of man-made death there is. And you can search that. I remember Dr. Bomber talked about that process of his body, what happened to Jesus' body. And it's excruciating. And then his heart basically explodes, right? I mean, he died of a broken heart, I think, was how you ended it, because it just overwhelms the body. And think of his mother, Mary, sitting there. Now, she's a follower, right? And because his mom was following, I'm sure his friends followed, and townspeople, and it all started to click, and they're all in. They're all bought in. And then the leaders come out and nail him to a tree, let alone the fact of nailing him to a tree. I've nailed myself. I've done that several times, you know. And they weren't very big compared to what they hung him on, you know. But his mom, Luella, Daryl's hanging out, and she had to sit there and watch that. Now, I would assume if I'm in there and, you know, heck, David or Devin, Drake are on a tree, Derek, I'm going to be digging. I don't got a tool. I'm going to dig with my hands so I can knock the pole over, right? That's what we think. I'm going to save my kid. I'm going to cut that tree down. You know, I'm going to get him off of there. Well, they couldn't. I mean, they would have done the same thing to them right then and there. It wasn't like our society now. So they had to sit there and watch that. Can you imagine that? I mean, think about that. So they watch. They go from thinking this is God. God can rule. God, this is our Savior. And they're all bought in. And then they kill him. Just like they can kill them. Human beings kill them. So to them, the world won, this earthly dying world won, right? Oh, I got duped, I got fooled, I believed in this, I sold out, I quit fishing for 3 years, I got no money. You know, I'm done. What, you know, I can't believe I fell for this. What the heck was I thinking? Did I see these things? I mean, they had to feel all that. But the truth is, and we know that now because we got the stories that they wrote us. They told us about it after it happened, so now we can see it. But the truth of that day was that God, that was a ministry. He set that day into action. He put those leaders in that. They put that in their heart to do that to Jesus. That was part of fulfilling the scripture. He decided all that would happen, not the people. He was in control. But they didn't know that then. And if it didn't all come true with the resurrection, we wouldn't have the power we have now. People wouldn't know what happened. We wouldn't get it. I just don't think the Christian faith would be where it's at without that. The concept of forgiveness of sin and peace, peace during pain, peace by being in a relationship with God and living in that purpose he has for you, that none of that can be real without God resurrecting Jesus. It just can't happen. There's no power there. If we don't get this resurrection gift, which is a gift to us as followers, as Christians, if we don't get that, if that doesn't happen, if we don't understand it, we don't accept it, we don't understand what he did for us, this is all bullshit. Everything we're doing, it isn't right, it's a waste of our time. It doesn't mean anything. Without the resurrection, the world wins. Humans win. Pain wins. Otherwise, why are we here? Without the resurrection, what we do is no different than any other club. Boy Scouts, the Anglers Club, the Elks Lodge, the Moose Lodge, Knights of Columbus. This church or a Christian organization that doesn't believe in that, there's no difference. And the activities that we do, when we're done with them, they're done. And just like those clubs, it's done. Because it's just physical being, it's just physical doing. The resurrection proves that God's word will indeed be or is true or come true. The resurrection of Jesus proves that God's power over humans' plans for control and evil is real. Those people that did that to Jesus, they didn't know that God was playing them as a puppet, but he was. There was a purpose in their life. Believe it or not, that was their purpose. God has control over evil. Just because we don't think he does, or we don't understand it because it happens, we have to understand he's in control. God told us that Jesus was to be sacrificed in death, or the blood of Christ, for our sins, and then to be raised, and of course we have these big fancy words, you know, resurrected. You know, he was to be raised from the dead. On the third day, he was to do that, to be seated at God's right hand to intercede for us, for you and for me, and for those people then, the people that died before Jesus, the people that are coming after us until he comes back. God says we get to the Father through the Son. Everybody agree with that? I'm not making that up, right? Without the resurrection, Jesus was just another lifeless human body brought to death by humans who thought they were in control. If without the resurrection, his followers wouldn't have received the Holy Spirit from the risen Jesus. Remember, they got the Holy Spirit from him after he had risen. That's the same Holy Spirit that we got today as followers. Same one, doesn't change, isn't any different, wasn't different before that. God held on to it and gave it out to very few. The resurrection sealed the deal for humans to accept the gift of being saved, or one of those other fancy words, salvation. If this wasn't so special, we wouldn't celebrate Easter, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the Son of God who was sacrificed for God's forgiveness of our sins. Grace comes with that. The resurrection is everything to my faith. Otherwise, this book and what we do here is just stories. That's all I got, ma'am. Thank you.
The resurrection is about relationship. The resurrection about, it's like Paul said, the Apostle Paul said, that if the resurrection didn't happen, then we are most to be pitied. Because, you know, everything we do is for naught. Everything we do is worthless. We are of all people, we're just fooling ourselves if the resurrection didn't happen. And it did happen indeed. You know, our Savior is not dead. He is alive. He is alive and well. You know, a lot of people just can't get past Jesus. They refuse to believe that he lived, let alone died and rose again in three days. They refuse to believe that. And I think the thing is that many people choose not to believe in Jesus. God, okay, God's okay. We can handle God. But Jesus, not so much. Because Jesus calls us to something. Jesus calls us to live new lives. Jesus calls us to live differently. Jesus calls us to turn from old lives. You know, a lot of people today, I see that watch the History Channel sometimes, and a lot of people today are trying to disprove. I mean, they're trying to prove Jesus' existence, and they've already proved that he did because they have evidence, and they have plenty of evidence that he lived. They have no evidence of his living after his resurrection, however, after his ascension. So they have evidence of that. They have plenty of evidence, but they still keep trying to disprove Jesus. People like scientists, atheists, and so on, they work it so hard disproving him. I think Timothy Keller said it well. He said, if Jesus rose from the dead, then you have to accept all that he said. If he didn't rise from the dead, then why worry about what he said? I mean, if people believe that he didn't exist, then why disprove something that doesn't exist? Someone. The issue on which everything hangs is not whether or not you like his teaching, but whether or not he rose from the dead. I think that's so true. No other God has pulled this one off, right? I mean, no other God pulled off dying for the sins, the wrongs of every person in the world. That's all inclusive, like Zeke said, you know, back then, everybody. And then coming back to life again so that these people that he died for, you and me, could accept the gift of sacrifice, the gift of forgiveness, the gift of a new life. Muhammad didn't do it. Buddha didn't do it.
Brahma, the Hindu god of Hindu, didn't do it. Confucius didn't do it, that's for sure. And neither did the god of self. Zeke alluded to that too. How many know that probably the most powerful god we have currently is the god of self? I can do it myself. Oh yeah, we can say I believe in Jesus and I believe in the resurrection, but then self gets in the way, doesn't it? I can do it myself. So only Jesus Christ is the one who did that. So number one for me is that the resurrection of Jesus assures our future resurrection, which it means that's also going to be a hope for us. If you are here and you believe you've taken Jesus to be a Savior of your life and Lord of your life, you have a hope in life after this. We've been talking about that for quite a few, since the beginning of the year. I read yesterday that former NFL tight end Todd Heap, he played tight end for the Baltimore Ravens, on Friday afternoon ran over his 3-year-old daughter and killed her. I cannot imagine a more heinous type of accident to happen. I mean, I just feel for the family. And I would venture to say that they're feeling pretty hopeless right now. They have 5 children. I would venture to say that life for them is just absolutely torn upside down. There's a lot of people that are like that. A lot of people today feel hopeless. A lot of people don't know where to turn sometimes. Tragedies happen every day, and many people live lives without any hope at all. Maybe some of you are feeling like there's not much hope. What do I have to hope for? I mean, look at the world, and it just seems to be going down the tube pretty fast, right? Let me encourage you that if you have Jesus as your Savior, you do have a hope. And a hope is in the future. Even though our world seems hopeless, there is hope in your future in eternity. I have great hope that, you know what? I don't have to stay like this. It doesn't have to be like this. Our hope lies in our future. Today is filled with problems, but our future is filled with glory. It's a wholly different story because Jesus died and rose again. Paul said this. He said, Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. Jesus has died and risen, so we know that our resurrected bodies will in some way resemble his resurrected bodies. Our resurrected bodies are going to be perfect. I know it's hard to imagine this, but, you know. Yeah, perfection, right. I just need to do a few more sit-ups, that's all. You know, we have a hope that, you know what? There is something greater, more glorious than this. As Jesus was in a resurrected body, so will we be. We don't understand to the extent, but we do know several things about him, that Jesus ate with his disciples, right? I like food. Looks like we're eating. Jesus, people could touch him physically, right? People recognized him, right? Did Mary, after he said her name, she recognized him. Other disciples recognized him. He showed up to more than 500 at one time after his resurrection. People recognized Jesus. We will recognize each other. Isn't that cool? I mean, I hope it's recognizing other people is good for him. I mean, maybe there's somebody you're trying not to recognize, but we'll work on that later. Understand, there is some hope in the resurrection. My second point is, the resurrection is proof, some of you may not like this, proof of a coming judgment. Now, being eternity-minded people, this is something we need to keep in mind. A coming judgment doesn't sound real exciting. You know, it sounds like, oh man, I don't even know. But it's something we need to know, that there is a coming judgment. We live in a culture right now where justice is often distorted and neglected. It seems like sometimes that people get unjustly accused, people get unjust, things happen to them. And we look at things and say, how can that be? How can this happen? But the good news and the hope is that in the resurrection, among other things, that God's justice will ultimately prevail. The great judge of all will prevail over other things. Okay, I said I was going to give you an opportunity to share, and I want to give you just a few moments. Does anybody here have a notion. What does a resurrection mean to you? In a word, not a soliloquy, but just a word or two. What does it mean to you? Anybody?
I try to use analogies as much as I can, and in the words of a song that I love, because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
It gives you hope. You can face tomorrow. It gives you strength, gives you courage to face the next day. Anybody else? Elaine.
Sacrifice.
Sacrifice.
You know, he sacrificed so much, so what little he asked us to sacrifice isn't nothing.
Okay, sacrifice, yeah. Charlie.
I'd say love. He loves us no matter what we do, no matter how we fail or just whatever. Yeah, it's awesome. Love is awesome.
He couldn't have loved us any more by dying, going to the cross, raising again so we can have the new life. Without the resurrection, there's new life, and then there's love. Yeah, absolutely. Anybody else?
To me, it's about hope.
Hope.
You never, you know, you always have hope no matter, like Charlie said, love or his sacrifice. But the bottom line is you always have help, hope.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Hope. Hope. Love.
It's like an old hymn says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
That's exactly what Linda said there.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it gives me another chance,
yep. You
know, which many times I need it.
Yeah. Isn't that good? Resurrection about second chances, isn't it?
He came for us. He kept his promise. He kept his promise no matter what it cost him. And he promised to come back and make a place for us. And he's resurrected and making a place for me now.
He is a promise keeper, and if he promised he would come back, he did, and he's going to come back again, isn't he? Anyone else?
Some years ago, I lived close to a man that was a Christian, and he just lived up the road, and his whole face was eaten away with cancer, and his scripture always was, I am the resurrection and the life. He that cometh will never die, but will live eternally. That's been a long time ago, but the hope that he had,
yeah. It
was contagious. I mean, it really spoke to my heart to know that we never will die, that we're eternal with Christ.
Amen. Amen.
To me, it's a guarantee of eternal life and salvation.
Amen. Amen. What a guarantee, huh?
It makes me think of Galatians 2:20, where I am crucified with Christ, that no longer I that live, but he that lives through me, and that we can live our lives through him and through what he's done on the cross.
Yeah. The life I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. Something like that. Amen. Amen. You know, those are good things. Those are all things that we need to do and need to recognize and remember that he does those things, and the resurrection is so powerful, giving us all those things. My last point today is that the resurrection gives you and me, and Zeke alluded to this too, I believe. I think it's really, for me, it's really important, is power. It gives us power. Power to live the life of a follower of Jesus. Let's rewind the story just a bit. Go back to, pretend you're living in the first century. You're in a first century home. You're in Jerusalem. And the events of the Holy Week have happened. You're in your home and you're sitting around, you're reclining at the table, laying down. And you've been talking about the events of the week. And you're talking about how, you remember this guy from this Nazarene came riding into town. You'd seen that type of thing before. He comes riding into town and everybody loved him. And then you talk about how he was beaten. And you talk about how everybody hated him by the end of the week, and how they crucified him, and how they put him in the tomb of a wealthy councilman. And then how that you'd heard that he was the tomb was empty 3 days later, and then somebody else at the table was saying, yeah, remember, he said he would do that, and you can't think about that stuff. You think, wow, just it made your head spinning on all this, right? A lot of things happened this week. How could this happen? When all of a sudden, a relative of yours who had died 20 years earlier. He was a very, very strong official in the synagogue, a holy person, walks in the door, and you go, oh, what? Uncle Jeremiah, I can't believe, oy vey. What do you say to that? When you see that person walk in, you know they died. You were there when they at the funeral. You put him in the tomb. Now you think, Tim, where are you going with this? Take a look. This is at the death of Jesus. At that moment, when Jesus died, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rock split. You talked about an earthquake. And the tombs broke open, and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs, and after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many people. So after Jesus died, went to the tomb, went to the grave, and the angel came. Now, you know what? The angel's job was to open the tomb of Jesus, right? This angel got a little carried away, I think, with power. And he opened a few more tombs, you know. And God's going, no, I just said one. But, you know, he opened the whole can of worms, so to speak. In Israel, as you look at the holy city, if you stand on the Mount of Olives, you look at the holy city, you can see the cemetery out in front. It's right outside the city walls. So I can just imagine this, that these tombs opened up, and it says people went into the holy city and appeared to many people. Let me tell you, that is resurrection power. When Jesus, so powerful, so mighty, comes from the grave, he brings other people back with him. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine that? And what evidence? People could say, if Jesus just rose from the grave, they could say, well, you know, they stole his body, which they tried to do. That's another story. They tried to pay and do that. But here, people's relatives, people's friends are back. How do you dispel that? How do you dispute that? That they came back as well. Now you have to say, well, something really happened. Something happened. That is resurrection power. Now, for us, you know, maybe life's not that dramatic. But let's go back to the text I read at the very beginning of the service day in Mark chapter 16. Mark 16. I want you to notice something about what the angel said to the woman of the tomb. She said, go, the angel said, to go tell the disciples. But look at this. Go tell the disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you. I think it's interesting that angels don't do anything without orders. And this angel was ordered to tell Mary to remind the disciples to go to the place that Jesus said he would meet them. But the angel also made sure that Mary said, and make sure you tell Peter. Notice he points out Peter on this, personally. And he asks the question, maybe, why Peter? She said tell the disciples. He was one of the disciples. Well, there's a lot of reasons probably, but how about the fact that it was Peter who, even though he walked with Jesus for three and a half years, was the second person that Jesus called to follow him. It was Peter who denied Jesus three times. It was Peter who turned his back on Jesus. It was Peter, the one who was bold, said, I will never do this. It was Peter who said, I've got a sword, Jesus, and you know, lop off the ear of a servant. It was Peter who was ready to go, ready to stand between Jesus and everybody else. But then it was Peter who turned his back on Jesus. There's a Peter that lives in each of us, isn't there? There's a Peter that says, I'm going to serve Jesus. And then we turn our back by what we watch, by what we say, and what we do, and what we don't do. Some ways we turn our back. You see, Peter, as bold as he was, he did not have the power to live the life on his own. The life for Jesus on his own. He didn't have that power. And people, you and me are like Peter. We need to have the resurrection power to live this life today because we can't live for Jesus on our own. I'm sorry. How many know you can't do it by yourself? We need that same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that broke open the tombs, the same power that did that. We can't do it alone. We mess up. and we need forgiveness, and we need power. The Apostle Paul was talking to a group of people about the Spirit of God and living in that power. And he said, but you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in you. And remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to Him at all. And Christ lives within you, and even though your body will die because of sin, the Spirit gives you life because you have been made right with God. Now watch this, people. The Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. It's what Zeke talked about that. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, He will give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit living in you. The Bible here isn't teaching that we will be sinless in this physical, in our physical bodies that we live in now. Instead, I think the Bible's teaching, I know the Bible's teaching that we can live sinless, not by our own abilities, but by the power of the Spirit. Christ makes us altogether different kinds of people. He changes us. 2 Corinthians 2, 7 tells us this. Therefore, if anyone's in Christ, he is what? A new creature. What happens then? The old things pass away. Behold, new things have come. When you said yes to Jesus, did life become new or not? Did it take root or not? God gives the power to live this Christian life to everybody. I'm going to invite Jeff and Joe May to come up here. I'll get out of your way here, Jeff. I want to show you one more quote before we go on here. N.T. Wright said this, "The resurrection completes the inauguration of God's kingdom. It is the decisive event demonstrating that God's kingdom really has been launched on earth as it is in heaven. The message of Easter is that God's new world has been unveiled in Jesus Christ and that you are now invited to belong to it." Let me just ask you, it is